We're back for round three and we've won the dice roll, so it's now do or die. This hand is excellent against really anything. We have removal for control, we have removal for creature decks, we have burn spells and recurring phoenix for control, we have perfect mana. This is a very easy keep. I'm excited. Our opponent keeps as well, let's wish him good luck. And lead off with a Boros Guild Gate. Depending what colours he is, we might shock ourselves next turn to keep up a removal spell. Alternatively, we might... Oh, looks like it might be the mirror. So I'm just going to play Mountain. In case he plays a 2-drop. It could be Red-White Devotion. They're really the only decks that run Guildgate. It'd be very funny. It looks very much like it could be the mirror. So we're going to Searing Blaze him. Sorry. Searing Blood him here. Which is nice. We've got a bit of an advantage. Untapped land? Nope. So we're not taking damage. Just got to control his board. He might... No, he's doing the same. Alright. Let's Magma Jet him. Setting up. You just want... Just want to find a War Leader's Helix. Lightning Strike, Boros Charm, these are both excellent. We'll keep both. Put the Lightning Strike first. Which means at the end of our next turn, we don't... He can't tap out here because we just resolved Chandra's Phoenix. Now, we know the next card is Boros Charm, so we'll Lightning Strike at the end of our turn. I'm not Chandra's Phoenixing because I don't want to get Searing Blooded, so I'd rather us both have a null card than potentially... So he's going for it. Alright, so he could have Shock, which is fine. We have Boros Charm on top. So really I just want my fourth land? And then just cast two spells till he's dead? Yeah. Yeah, we want to do that. Now he could have... He's leaving up Shock mana. So bottom... Bottom. Because if he's running the stock list... Yeah, we just want to... I don't mind if he shocks my Phoenix, because that's easy to get back, and it's not scary. Alright, we're just going for it. Phoenix into Phoenix. Didn't find land, didn't find a Warlord's Helix. So it turns out we should have bottomed one more card, be one card deeper into our deck, but, you know, that's hindsight. Now, if he has Shock, I don't really mind. Does have Shock. So he's at 13, we have 9 points of burn, we have a Phoenix. We're in a good position. Hopefully he doesn't have the Searing Blood. Now, a good play would be like main phase War Leader's Helix. Alright. I'm just gonna keep... I'm just gonna pass the turn. Wanna represent Skullcrack. If we hit our fifth land, then I'll play the Phoenix. And I don't mind... Alright, so he's just going for it. Really going for it. So the question is, do I just want to put him to 4 and then try and Phoenix him out? So I can go strike, strike, land. So he's not dying. So 3 cards in hand versus 4 cards in hand. I'm actually going to kill his Phoenix here. I'm judging that to be worth more. I can get back my Phoenix as well. Really just want to draw Warlord's Helix. That would be the best. But he has 6 land in play is nice. But it might be that he has a Searing Blood in hand. Maybe I can take that risk, maybe I can't. That would give him his Phoenix back, which is so bad for us. Warlord's Helix. Probably can't beat that. Ugh. So I'm probably dead next turn. He's at 17. Yeah. Game 1 is very much about who draws the Warlord's Helix, who has the Skullcrack, that sort of thing. He's got 2 cards in hand. One is a Phoenix. Boros Charm. Wow. That's not good for us. We've got a pass turn here because we can't beat... We play our Phoenix and swing, he can just Searing Blood it. Like, it's, the Phoenixes are now dead, unfortunately. And it looks like he has the burn, so we may as well make him go through the motions. Post board, we have some pretty good tech for this matchup, especially if he doesn't, which he might not be expecting. So we have Spark Troopers and we have Blind Obedience, which are all excellent. Alright, I'm going to put him to 10 and we're all in. So we're hoping his last card is land, because there's almost nothing, like, we almost can't beat anything here. Goes to 10, and War Leader's Helix? Oh wow, we drew it. Alright, I'm just going to main phase this. Mostly because I believe if he had a actual burn spell that would kill us, he would have had to cast it last turn, which means he probably has a Searing Blood as his last card. And I'm happy for that to remain dead. Go up to 6 with 2 Phoenix in hand. So hopefully he just blanks off for a turn. Does not look like he did. Ash Zealot. That's awesome here. Now we're back in the hole. So I'm putting his last card in hand as Searing Blood. So our Phoenixes are now, unfortunately, the two of them we have in hand are both meaningless. Alright, well, we have to play it. Maybe it's just another land. It's almost certainly a Searing Blood, but we can't not play Phoenix here, because we need to at least credibly race him. If we don't, the Ash Zealot just kills us, so. Oh, wow. Alright. Can we get that lucky? Because we might be able to just kill him next turn, if he doesn't have it. It's gone right down to the wire. Game 1 in the Burn Mirror is very draw-dependent. But post-sideboard, you can really reconfigure your deck. That he's taking this long... Ooh. I like that. He could just be completely flooded. Or we need him to be completely flooded. Any 3-point burn spell obviously kills us. We need to draw a burn spell to go... Yeah, so... Alright, we're just all in. Man, we really drew poorly. I'm putting him on having nothing. He has to have nothing. It'd be great to steal game one from this position. Oh, we did! Outstanding! Outstanding! Oh, that's so awesome. We had to get quite lucky there, although both players did flood out. I made one incorrect scry decision that game, but thankfully our opponent was drawing just as poorly as we were. I like to take out my Ash Zealots. I don't think they're particularly good, because they let your opponent trade one for one with value with a card like Searing Blaze, Searing Blood or Magma Jet. So instead, I like to take them out, bring in Chain to the Rocks and Blind Obedience. That neuters all their haste guys, and the incremental life gain is extremely powerful. I don't bring in Spark Trooper. I find it very hard to hit them with unless your opponent plays directly into it, and having to, at sorcery speed, tap out for 4 mana just to get shocked, and then your opponent, like, War Leader's Helix you in response or something like that is just extremely bad. It's a lot better on the play when your opponent might tap out for turn 3 Phoenix and you can turn 4 Spark Trooper them back, but I've actually it's not really for this matchup. As obviously, if you hit them, you just win, but I find it very difficult to do that. As you saw, the game is mostly just played at instant speed. Alright, so we're going to go to game 2.